Hello and welcome back everybody to the second part of 7 days. Blee blah bloop, it has been a while, blah blah blah, the same old shit I talk every time I disappear and appear again. I'm sorry it has been a while, but now we're finally here for the second part. So for those of you who don't follow me on social media, I've recorded the second episode of 7 days before, like a year ago, and then unfortunately my PC broke, and I'm a little bit spoiled on the contents of the second episode, but fortunately I haven't played any further, so I'm only a little bit spoiled, and also it has been a year, so I'm not 100% sure anymore what's going to happen. But we shall see, don't we? So let's go! So we were standing at the bus stop last time, and we had the protagonist's sad backstory, etc. I had to rewatch the episode so that I can remember all that stuff. But again, it has been a year. 410. Our bus is going to hell. Having taught punctuality, life has taught me nothing else. And it didn't definitely didn't add any smartness. That is why I wave my hand to the driver of the Lias, an old red one. Now you always never see them. Everything has been replaced by European-made new ones. Whoops! Wah! No, no, no! What the fuck? Apparently I hit the wrong button. What the fuck was that? No! But as you can see, I didn't lie. I've played the second episode before. Whoops. Okay, please load this again. Yes, I'm sure I want to load. What the hell was that? What button did I... Okay. Well, that's a good start. Oh, I'm gonna leave this in, why not? I'm only human after all. Where is it, the promised hatred towards the person that destroyed you? Communicating with Oksana almost killed me once. But she called and asked me to come. Oh yeah, I kind of remember. Not a good idea to go there, friend, but we'll see. Logic, my old friend. I can only wonder why she called me. Let's just assume there is a reason. Probably not a good one. Suppose something very bad is waiting for me there. But sometimes love is not happiness at all. Sometimes it is a burden and a curse. That is why I had to take the risk. The world changed over the last 10 years. I changed. One thing was certain. I still... Something. Was this supposed to be like that, or is this a bug? I closed my eyes. She made an appointment at the Central Park of Culture. Somewhere near the skating rink, she said that she would be waiting for me at the box. My New Year's gift. A gift in a game where the winner loses everything. Well, I was expecting something like this. Loki didn't have a good ending either. Was that a reference? I mean, it's a reference to Nordic mythology, obviously, but... Oh yeah, we had to... I remember, we had to decide in the beginning... I remember, okay. I was confused for a second what this had to do with Loki. Therefore, when the already familiar foe went at me, stretching out in a chain, I was not even scared. Yeah, but you're a little bit dumb, to be honest. Like, you're not the smartest. Like, going there without backup, that's, I mean, I get it, he's a loner, maybe he doesn't have backup, but nah, I mean, nah. Oh well, that's it, folks, I said to myself. Two lighters, comfortably lying in fists, a transparent St. Petersburg night, and the love of my life. That is it. I went to them, ran towards the evil sparkle of eyes frozen grins, blunt-toed boots, which are so convenient for breaking ribs. Loki, Asgard sentence you to death. My echo laughed up. No, the other way around. My laughter echoed across the universe. From the ring came the sounds of another pop tune, and I laid in deep snow and looked at the lantern whose light cut the icy air in thick slices. It was terribly cold, but I could not move. It looked like they hit somewhere where not everything has healed yet. So I was not surprised at the feeling of warmth. I heard that this has happened with freezing people. And under the closed eyelid, a strange picture was found. Plaster pioneers frozen in the moments of flight, standing on the opposite sides of the half-open figured gate with pegs on top. Night in complete silence, broken only by the singing of cicadas. And only a voice familiar from childhood, calling to a land of no return. Will you go with me? Right on time, as usual. What am I losing anyway? Of course we will. I guess I will stay here is like 99% likely a bad end. I don't remember if I tried it out, but again, like 99% likelihood for a bad end. So I will follow you, honey. Hope neither she, nor him, nor that damned quartet will be there. First, the pain stopped mattering. Then the raw sensations in the bruised cheeks and the gurgling in the lungs disappeared. The cold stopped mattering. And... by the way, I'm... what? What in the fuck? Change log for version 054. Finish day one of the final route. Added 4 new CGs. Changed some endings and events in different routes. A lot of minor changes. Okay. Thank you. That didn't happen last time, so apparently they... they changed some things? Was following her the bad end? Like I died or what? Okay. Then let's try this again. Oh, whoops, I didn't want to press start the game. Okay. So we're not supposed to follow her. We are supposed to stay here. First, the pain stopped mattering. Then the raw sensations in the bruised cheese and the gurgling in the lungs disappeared. The cold stopped mattering. And... there was no more cold. The girl that I dreamed about all my life smiled at parting, and a bitter tear froze on her perfect cheek. New Year's, life drinking, icy mood took me into arms. Heart knocked on tomorrow's door. Knock, knock. But nobody respond. Huh? Now I'm a little bit confused. Aha. If I start the game over from the beginning, then stuff works, apparently. I mean, it makes sense. They made some changes, so my save file probably was broken or something. Well, the bus, some familiar faces. I suddenly realized that the entire world became pitch black water. Maybe this is the same hell I was so scared of. Cold darkness and complete lack of air. And I so want to leave everything as is and throw myself into an endless freefall towards the bottom. I had no more strength for resisting. Movement became slower and slower. Soon I was moving straight down. That's what I personally call a dying, but that's just me. And when I hit the bottom, I realized that I was just sleeping. That's what I call a coma. Roaring frost swapped out for searing heat. Seems like I went straight into my own personal hell. It's stuffy, dark, and cramped in here. And pretty boring. The strangest part was that there was no pain. That tearing, burning feeling from the inside when something burst inside me under the blow of a boot disappeared forever. Forever? You feel no pain in Sovyonok in the future, or in the parallel, however you want to call it. Being completely bored out of my mind, I opened my eyes and immediately met someone's gaze. Interested stare, like I'm some kind of exotic animal. A girl. Cute one, I noted mechanically. The most logical thing would be to smile at her, but I always have problems with that. Yeah, I feel you, bro. To be honest, I'm not the greatest at smiling either. Like, it always seems mechanic when I do it. I had a feeling I knew her. We didn't actually know each other, but I swear I saw her somewhere. Yeah, I'm still wondering that no one has yet filed a lawsuit in Japan, because Japanese people are very happy to do lawsuits. We actually had, how do you call it, a small shop that was called Jindujun, like the thing Son Goku in Dragon Ball rides in the beginning of the series, and the little cloud. And they actually got like a cease and desist or something from Japan. Even though it was like a store that sold candy and newspapers and stuff. Jesus, Japanese people, don't fuck around with their copyright. Maybe we met on the street. I mean, aquamarine eyes and a hair of a shade that is referred to in print as Cyan. I would definitely remember them if I ever saw them. Not to mention the exotic outfit. A clear imitation of Soviet pioneers. Sorry, sweetie, but you're a bit too old to be a pioneer. Yeah, that's true. We looked into each other's eyes for a few seconds before she nodded and, after drumming up a rhythm on the glass with her nails, ran away. On the glass? Wait, I'm on a bus? But I definitely remember. I remember. What? I definitely remember that I got on the bus and went somewhere. Whether I arrived was a different question. From some point, a black blind spot was gaping in my memory. To be honest, might be better for you. Wow, I'm wondering right now, are those custom drawings? I feel like I didn't see those drawings in the original game. I wouldn't swear an oath on it, but I'm pretty sure those are custom drawings. It was summer outside. Not far from the bus, a second girl was waiting. A little taller than the first, also very beautiful, with copper red hair that shone fearfully in the bright sun. Cyan girl ran up to her and said something, quickly waving her arms, while the redhead silently and a little condescendingly listened to her. Then answered something, and the Cyan one laughed, somehow finally, crumblingly, as only Asians can. All this time I've been sitting trying to get myself to move. I definitely wasn't crippled by paralysis, considering I managed to open my eyes. No, you were crippled by boots, but you know. By the way, I just wanted to say, like, the one thing I'm kind of surprised about is, like, they are in St. Petersburg. They are in a public park. I mean, it was late at night. Maybe it was that late at night, but I'm wondering that nobody called the police or something. Both girls left, leaving me alone. A few moments later, movement abilities were returning to me. Finally, I managed to turn my hat. Cutscene over. Yep, that's definitely not the Lias I boarded, or Lias, or however you pronounce it. Armchairs stretched in pair along the cabin, freeing a narrow passage in the middle, reminiscent of regular Icaruses from my distant childhood. And I'll be damned if this ain't an Icarus. I collapsed into a chair. Yep. What the hell is going on? Some painted Asians, redheads, and not even one went into the salon and helped the disabled. That's probably a reference I don't get. It was unusually empty in my ears. The earphones fell out and were making a low noise somewhere on my chest. Catching the escapees, I tried to put them in place, but they, without even stopping, instantly fell out. Did they break? Out of the frying pan, into the fire. Turning off the player, I headed to the exit. For some reason, there was absolutely no fear. Modern man is rarely surprised at anything. Nah, man, I don't know. I'd be very surprised if I traveled to the past. Or at least seemingly past. And here, the miracles have simply already chosen a quota, so all that remained for me was to listlessly state the amazing. Whoops, oh, I'm skipping again! Fucking controller, son of a bitch! Okay. You know what? We'll do this next episode. Because now I've got to throw my controller at the wall. Maybe that helps. Ah, oh, Jesus, I'm so sorry. But we've came quite a bit further. So now we arrived at Sovyonok. Simeon got stomped out, who would have thought. And apparently he's like in a coma or something. It's actually quite interesting, like a backstory, because, you know, the original game was quite vague on the backstory. I mean, this one has to be, or at least probably likely, is something like a coma dream. I guess we'll see in the end. But I'm curious where this goes. So, thank you everybody for watching. Come back for next episode where we'll continue with Simeon leaving the bus. And I'll see you then. Bye-bye. Sorry everybody, skipped ahead again with my fucking controller. I wonder how that happens. Maybe if I push the button too long or something. I should just use a mouse. Anyway. Out of the frying pan into the fire. Turning off the player, I headed to the exit. For some reason, there was absolutely no fear. Oh yeah, we already read that. Ah, well, there we go. It would be better for my psyche anyways. Nothing that I will was still flaunting my winter clothes. Another item on a growing list of questions. I threw off my overcoat, out of place in the seat, and began to make my way to the exit. For how long was I sleeping that winter managed to end? Or am I still sleeping? I pinched myself. The pain sobered me up, but I still couldn't wake up. Well, time for recon. The door was open, so I climbed out without any interruptions. And at the same moment, half-strangled panic reared its head again. Because my eyes landed on a picture that haunted me all my adult life. I couldn't remember when I first dreamed of those ball-painted gates. But I remembered them, in detail. In detail! From the pecs on top going further along the brick wall in both directions, as far as the eye could see, to the five-pointed star at the junction of the wings. Although it was always night in my dreams. And now the day was in full swing. Yes, and I was not in a dream now, but in reality. I stood stumblingly, swallowing bitter saliva, rolling my eyes, rocking diligently out of phase with gravity. 4 exhales, 2 inhales, pulsating, ringing in my ear. And snapped in half, turned inside out, praying for death as a deliverance from suffering. Jesus, that must be pain. The roots of the hair hurt, the eyeballs, the skull from the inside. Not surprisingly, in a moment I found myself standing on all fours and looking at a brown puddle, the contents of my stomach in the grass. Oh, gotta get up, I absent-mindedly noted. With great difficulty, I managed to crawl back to the bus, sitting on the step, took out my phone from my pocket. I gotta call someone. In a different situation, I would have been surprised to see Xana's number last in the call log, but now it didn't matter. What the? I took the receiver away from my ear and checked the reception quality, but instead of at least the minimum signal, there was a fat red cross on it. The operator's signal was lost. Profusely cursing, I slammed my fist on the bus. Modern man has other ways to shout to civilization in addition to mobile phones. I tried to check all of them. However, numerous wireless networks in the phone were silent. Even GPS, completely in the open. God damn. Is this a joke? To be honest, in Germany that happens so often. I don't know how well internet works in Russia, but to be honest, in Germany, not having wireless LAN somewhere or Wi-Fi or something, then we're so backwards regards to the internet that that's not so super surprising. I remember traveling by train through like a foresty region, and I had no connection to the internet anywhere, as if we were like in an untouched Amazonian region or something. A sharp pain in my temples was the last thing I felt before I fell into oblivion. Seven days, day one, first meeting. Looking for him? And he's just sleeping here. A voice came from nowhere. I swung my head around, trying to understand where the voice was coming from. And after painfully smashing my head on the door, I opened my eyes. It is my favorite girl with my favorite silhouette. Because of the bright sun directly shining into my face, it was impossible to see who was talking to me. But at least the contours of the figure, clearly female, could be distinguished. Now what? With confirming the reputation of a loser again? Didn't even have time to move or go somewhere, and I already screwed up somewhere. Amazing, isn't it? Woman or girl, she continued to say something in raised tones, waving her hands, but I hardly perceived her. Everything swam before my eyes. The noise in my ears obscured the sounds, and I, trying to get up, convulsively grabbed the doorstep. Are you okay? No, stupid woman, I am not okay. What are these questions? Did you overdose on Hollywood films? Listen, dude. Listen. I don't care what you say about yourself or whoever, but... Hey, You better be nice to Slavia, otherwise we may have a problem here. As usual, I barked to myself. Not a word left my lips, I swear. Yeah, you better, you fucking asshole. But the girl took a step back, obviously shocked by something. And I finally managed to take a good look at her face. Definitely a girl. Very young, very beautiful. At home, I called such celestials and avoided their company with all my might. Can I just say something? Like... Jesus fucking Christ. Isn't our protagonist supposed... I mean, if he was like a really... like a teenager. But this dude is supposed to be an adult. How in the fuck does he run around and think, oh, these women are celestial. Hey, like, Jesus fucking Christ. What kind of incel nonsense is that? I swear to God, if we're going to talk about Stacy's and shit like that, Our social categories are too different. Our social circles are too different. If such an angel wants to send to me, it is only because they need something from me. Usually something directly involving my skills. One already descended once. I'm still having a hard time sorting that mess out. Together with other oddities, the presence of such beauty next to me did not add peace to me at all. The reaction was expected. I was on guard. Did anything happen? There is no reality in which I will ever ignore Slavia. Did you want something? Ah, you spoke. I don't know why she was happy. Seemed like here people didn't talk to her that much. Or maybe she was concerned for you, Amazing achievement, not going to lie. Get to the point. Why are you so angry? Everything is fine. I replied, casually marveling at the unexpectedly high tone my throat exuded. Spectacular. The first thing came out of my throat is a voice crack. Oh. I mean, makes sense, you know. Although, I don't know about you people, but my voice change when I was a teenager happened like in the course of a few weeks. And that sounds stupid, but it's really true. Like, I barely had any voice cracks or something. Or at least to a very minimal degree. Can this first impression get any worse? Please tell me. I'll try to help. The girl smiled irresistibly. So charmingly. Openly. It didn't diffuse the situation. It got only worse. That is right. The more sincere is the smile, the heavier the stone is in the bosom. Okay. Everything is fine, I repeated. Yeah? Well, all right. I was reading comments the other day that I forgot to answer, and there are a few. And someone wrote like 2 years ago or something. Someone was complaining about me not reading some Russian names. For example, Olga's. I mean, it's possible to say Olga Dmitrievna. I can do my best, you know, but I'm so far into this journey with Everlasting Summer. Now going over to actually correctly address her is kind of weird. So we'll stick with Olga. Olga sent me to meet you because the bus had already arrived half an hour ago and you still hadn't shown up. Olga Dmitrievna. Name didn't ring any bells. Hell, it could be some bang ding ow. And it has stunned about the same, I don't know, bang ding ow. Ah, okay. Squad leader, she explained. I remembered the first person I saw when I opened my eyes. That Japanese roly beauty in pioneer uniform. And my current interlocutor was dressed up in exactly the same way. White shirt, scarlet tie, and mid-thigh skirt. The only thing missing is the I won't forget Ilyich tattoo for complete authenticity. Is that something you do these days? Like if you're like a devoted communist or something like that, you get a I won't forget Ilyich tattoo? Poor Lenin, what do they do that you probably wouldn't have wanted? Got it. So let's write it down. We're playing pioneers. Even the squad leaders were abroad. From somewhere on the other side came a sound that I, straining my memory, identified as a horn. Right, pioneer reenactment. And she suddenly got worried. Listen, I would love to chat with you, but time does not wait. I've got to go, so much to do. And here we smoothly approach the delegation of authority. And nobody else other than me is going to do things, so you have to be on your own, okay? The girl took out a piece of paper, folded in four, from her pocket. Thought I'd see you off myself, but okay. The paper turned out to be a map. Yeah, I know that map. Has been a while, but I know that map. Look, We are here. She pointed to a rectangle signed in someone's beautiful handwriting as bus stop. There was a bold red cross. And you need to go here. To Olga's house, cabin number 17. Ah, okay. Even in this reality, I'm living with Olga. It always happens. You know how to navigate by map, right? She smiled, as if negative response couldn't be possible for her. I'll try. Great. Let me offer you small advice. What? You see, it's not the beginning of shift now. You are very late. She shrugged her shoulders as she suddenly chilled, and I silently nodded, saying that I understood I was late for the beginning of the shift to the camp, and for free too. And your clothes? She took a look at my jeans and sweater. I nodded. The clothes were not only out of season, but also attracted attention. Strange that this blonde isn't asking any questions. And I didn't last long. This pause clearly overstayed its welcome. And the camp has its own traditions. Well, if you see a group of people with buckets, run. They're most likely after you. Seemed logical enough to me. If we're reenacting that age, we gotta do it properly. Including penalties. Got it. I nodded. I have to go now. Welcome to Sovyonok, by the way. Bye-bye, or won't I get lost? Oh man, I can't remember what I chose originally. I guess won't... I mean, in reality. You know, I usually like to play these games like I decide what I would say in reality. You know? And in reality, I'd probably say bye-bye. But won't I get lost? I get the feeling that we maybe stick with Slavia. So we choose won't I get lost. You weren't sent without any reason. Actually, no. She pondered for a few seconds, and then shook her head. But you're also right. Together we will get there much faster. Let's go. Yay. She grabbed my hand, wee, and pulled me along. Ah, walking with the girls, holding hands. What kind of romantic nonsense is this? As if you're 4 years old, you're singing Katoshka, and in the group a glass of jelly and a laughing grandmother educator are waiting. I've already forgotten when the last time was I walked with someone like that. I froze up, again looking around the gate. Why are you just standing there? Let's go. You see, I've seen this place in a dream. You see, I wanted to beat my head against soft walls, yell, tearing my throat. Give me haloperidol clopromazine. Okay, that's probably some kind of drugs. Anything to confirm that this is really not true. Is everything okay? She asked. You look scared. Of course I would be. And your places, your people. I answer ambiguously, but it seems to the girl that that was enough. Don't worry, you'll like it here. She pushed the gate, letting me through, and followed. I wonder why there always this picture appears all the time, or if this is just like a loading screen. I think we're close to the territory where I ended the episode last time. I think we will meet like one or two pioneers, and then I'm in stranger territory. Behind the gate was a pioneer camp. What a twist, right? Everything is new, fresh. The concrete slabs that paved the path have now not yet been beaten, although greenery has already managed to break through here and there. And what has always amazed me in such places, the houses inscribed in nature with amazing skill. Centuries-old pines, undisturbed by anyone, landscape irregularities turned to decorations. On either side of the path were some small buildings that looked equally shabby, but the one on the right was rightly closed. Tightly closed, and the door was completely replaced by a fire shield with hooks, conical buckets, and a red fire extinguisher. The building on the left was much more interesting. Judging by the sign, this is the building of the hobby groups. Or, as the authors of that sign pretentiously stated, clubs. More importantly, there was a girl. Another beauty in this unsettling place. She smiled at my guide, but stumbled a bit when she caught my eye. She immediately looked down and blushed almost to tears. No matter the reality, I know you're carrying a knife somewhere. I'm serious. Her eyes were glistening. The girl looked down at the floor in embarrassment and smiled shyly. Did she smile at me? And then, without detecting a response, she hid her smile, leaving me to wonder if it didn't seem like it at all. Why, yes, this is how it all begins. First, we arrive from winter on the Icarus, then we sink at a speed, often one affection per minute. And then, as usual, a cheerful house with yellow walls, polite orderlies, and a shirt from Cardin with the ties on the back. Ah, okay, I get it. He's talking about an asylum, okay. I stood almost in the same stupor, also frozen, wondering whether to approach at the risk of scaring her off, or to give the initiative to her. Honestly, the most polite thing to do right now would be leaving. I would be thankful to myself if I ever ended up in a situation like this. But then why don't my legs work? The silence was becoming frightening, and I already decided to clear my throat in order to somehow break the silence, as we were interrupted. Neighboring bushes crackled, and a girl jumped out onto the road. Short in a scarlet t-shirt with the slogan USSR, and with the muzzle of an eternally cheerful, happy, and dirty little sister. Completely red hair, pulled together by two tail rockets, a cute appearance, which was, excuse me, confidently spoiled by the abyss of slyness splashing at the bottom of blue eyes. From a distance, she seemed very small and was definitely younger than everyone I had seen here before. I wonder why they decided to do that in the game. I mean, I get it. It has to do with Ulyana was like a mascot of a message board and some stuff like that. But at the same time, wouldn't it have been like a more natural decision to age her up? Oh well. I wanted to say or ask something, but I didn't have the time. The rat jumped up to the girl and started talking about something, waving her arms excitedly. She in turn was embarrassed, lowered her eyes and said nothing.
Ulyana. Aye, aye, boss.
Sincerely smiled the kid.
Ulyana.
My guide spelled it out again.
What?
Don't pretend. You understand everything.
Nerd.
I don't know. I wonder what it said in Russian. Let me know in the comments. What did it say in Russian? Is there like a good word for nerd in Russian? Because actually there isn't in German. If you want to call someone a nerd in German, you actually have to call him a nerd. Like, there is no, like, good word for nerd. The closest thing is, like, a Streber or something. But Streber is not really, like, including people who, like, play games and such, but only people who do very well at school. So, I mean, I don't know. Let me know in the comments what it said in Russian. She pouted, unclenching her palm. From there, something oblong, green, crackling on the fly jumped up. What the hell was that? A grasshopper? The red hair stamped her foot, showed us her tongue, and disappeared. Green Eyed stood for a while, coming to her senses. Apparently she understood what she had just been saved from. Then, squeezing out something unintelligible, she returned back to the clubs. Great start. What else can you say? I glance at my guide, but she smiles serenely. All right, okay. I understood and accepted the rules, pioneering, traditions, practical jokes, and grasshoppers in a fist. Do I have to wear shorts too? Well, someone will finally check the lists and fail to find me and return me back to my homeland with an apology. However, apparently, it is Olga who does the checks. Then I'll have to get acquainted with her. I think this is where I last time... I think I'm probably in new territory. Although I can still skip ahead, so I don't know. Or could you always skip ahead in Everlasting Summer? I can't remember. Anyway, I think this might be a good place to stop, actually. We're probably going to Olga now. We got to meet Ulyana, Lena, and Slavia. We got stomped out and nearly killed. I mean, that's very much that we already did, didn't we? So thank everybody for watching. I apologize once again for my very long absence. It won't be this long again till the third episode, I promise you that. So thank you again, and we'll see each other next time. Bye-bye.